I'm glad to introduce Paul and Mariah.
Are you?
And I think I'll let you say everything else you have to say.
Okay. I think what I'll do this evening is move over here and get into a paper shuffling very fast. Since 1969, I've edited a magazine called ManRoot in San Francisco. I brought some of the issues with me, and I think what I'll do is I'll warm up on my material, on material from the magazines, and then I'll read some of my own. This is ManRoot 6-7, which is a 192-page surrealism issue with 30 pages of Paul Eluard and 30 pages of Nanos Valeritas. This is called 34 and a half poems, and it's those kind of things that you write on napkins, on matchbook covers, etc. And sometimes you never finish them, and sometimes you just leave them in their fragments. Anyway, I got tired of having them on separate pieces of paper and decided to cohese them and call them 34 and a half poems. One, nobody lives in a straight line. Two, I'm glad that I stood among the grateful dead with a messenger quick as silver slapping palms. We psalmists know a way of talking without voice. Three, there's a green and glorious beast who lives behind my eyelids. Four, it was only after man had gone to the moon that he began to realize the earth was holy and home. The artist, the holy men, have said such for years to deaf ears. Five, sit still and grow wings. Six, someone larger than I lived my life yesterday. Seven, I have never drunk the juice from the tree I most adore. Seven and a half, his thing, a bottle of olives, the other half is him. Eight, not props, but triggers to a better understanding of the world we have to live in. Nine, this song is as soft as the song the spider's web sings. If I were an eagle, I would toughen my stomach to endure even the metal of those other birds. 11. In the web of a shadow, these words shape themselves. 12. Forever, for real, go to hell, Mrs. Kilgore. All suited up in suitable suits, seersucker suited. 13. He who is not busy being born is busy dying. 14, Yanni Christu, inatiodromia, a sacrifice. 15, my feet have lost the grip of pigeons' gray concrete. 16, you ain't no better than your fucking. 17, Harry Claphorn. 18, leatherific. 19, your jack went off and did it with others. 20, a black derby with her horsehair trailing down the back curve. 21, YMCA is ever so gay. 22, I must eat the black rainbow that encircles the earth. 23, insurance companies adjust the price of pain. 24, this is a tinfoil poem. 25, who is holding the nail? 26, please pay when served, right? The little sign on the, a form of cannibalism, the air still eats my flesh. 28, Zether, canopy tails. 29, the day the anarchist wrapped the policeman's car in toilet paper. 30, when my boy becomes your girl. 31, this is a, it's hard to read. It's like a dialect. And I took it as a tribal dialect. And by tribal, I mean tribes. And I heard it on the Fillmore bus. And these two women behind me were talking. And suddenly, one of them said to the other one, "Don't you quit him, you'll cut your finger off. Don't you quit him, he'll cut your finger off." She was telling her to be cool or he'll get possessive, and that's violent. And she was warning the other woman where the violent line stood in their life. 32, retroactive virginity. Rubinstein at 82 playing Mozart again. 33, not even the birds know where they are going. 34, space, zen. That which is empty is filled. That which is filled is empty. Somebody's at the back door. There's a black woman by the name of I.A.I. I think Houghton Mifflin did her book last year. These were four poems of hers that were in ManRoot 8, and ManRoot 8 is a 120-page issue devoted to womanhood. Most of the contributors are women. There are a few men in the issue. And this is I's poem called "Tired Old Whore." "This is my property. I laid for it, paid for it, you know. And I just want to build a cement walkway right up to my front door. I'll be the only whore within 50 miles who can claim I did something with my hands that didn't get a man hard. What? I'm so tired. Can't you wait a while? I'm 45. My breath is short. I like to sleep alone. Yeah, yeah. I rolled in my jelly and it felt good. But this belly isn't wood or steel. Man, you're a steering wheel. Turn your butt to my face. But wait, I need a little help. Help me, sweet thing. Pull down your pants. I like to see what's getting me now before it gets into me."
Yeah.
Woo. This is, and this is by a woman that is very active in the gay activist, lesbian, and women's movement. Her name is Judy Grahn, G-R-A-H-N. And sometime I'd like to have you invite her up. She's lovely people. And this is a poem of hers. And her, she reversed in the title as the last line in the poem, not the first, okay? "The big horsewoman walked out to the mountain. It was early in the morning. Nobody was around. She was carrying a blanket, and she spread it on the ground. She sat down hard upon it and made a moaning sound. The mountain wind was blowing, and she shuddered once or twice as she pressed down on her belly that was cold and blue as ice. Red was above the mountain, and red was in her eyes, and red the water running on the big horsewoman's thighs. A herd of speckled ponies came up the hill behind, with four mares in the head and two horse colts behind. When she stood up finally, she smiled like a rising sun, and whatever she had on her mind, she didn't tell no one." This poem is called "How Naomi Gets Her Period." And that's by Judy Grahn, who lives in Oakland. And that's ManRoot 8. ManRoot 9 is ManRoot 9 is a lavender issue. There's translations of 10 contemporary Greek poets, and so I call it a Greek lavender passion issue. Let's see what we can read from here. I don't dare. I can't. I don't. No, that one's. This is by a young poet who is living in Canada now because of the draft. He's from San Diego area. His name is Jack Thomas. And he's published at least 7 porno novels under about 5 different names. He calls this At the Porno Factory. All the windows are shaped like keyholes. We don't look out. Colorblind, we see only in black and white, a paper world. Each file cabinet unfolds the private life of the mattress. The sauna in the elevator is filled with naked girls, flesh-starved secretaries and terrified typists bound with a telephone cord. The receptionist is spread-eagled on her desk, repeating by rote, "A little pain never hurt anyone." And the mail chute is a Freudian slip, and the elevator goes down on anyone. In the next cubicle, someone breaks out of his head and sticks his tongue in the pencil sharpener, and the typewriter pecks kisses at his crotch. He needs a novel, live, free of print. I write him into the story of blind women who love making brooms. I get scared someone will write me into the story. I try to call out for help, but the telephone gets juicy and sucks at my ear. My pen turns into a chicken foot. Even the pencils go limp. I want to be a nun. that's ManRoot 9. ManRoot 10 is a 200-page issue we devoted to Jack Spicer. Jack Spicer is out of the late 40s era in Berkeley. His collected poems just came out from Black Sparrow this year, edited by Robin Blazer. Duncan considered him a contemporary and peer, though technically Robert was older. Jack was very active in the Bay Area from the late 40s through 65 when he passed away. He was gay, he was an alcoholic. He hung out in a bar in North Beach, and people would flock over and listen to him while he would rant and rave and discourse very loudly. Very bold man in many ways, and yet very deprecating about his own body and his own self. I wish I had. From what we did was, Jack's work had been out of print for years, and we gathered up poems of his from magazines and from typescript copies, and I begged and borrowed manuscripts and notebooks and everything else for 4.5 years just to make this one issue of a magazine. This is called Indian Summer, Minneapolis, 1950. Jack Spicer. What did the Indians do in a hot Indian's October? Did the same things, I suppose. Saw the birds flying, gathered the last corn, the same things. Saw the birds flying, followed their muddy river, looking the last time for a warm face to kiss in winter. The same things, their muddy river still muddy, the woods choked with red leaves under a sun bright like a bright promise, watched the birds flying, and dirty October moved like their river with a heat that frightened the birds away. This is a little fragment like those 34 and a half poems, the first one I read. This is a fragment that Jack had dated in his manuscripts July 1955. And it's a four-liner, it's a quatrain. It goes, "And no one is around to see my tears but Priapus, the ugly gardener's son, who squats among the flowers with his shears and doesn't have the hots for anyone." You know, like, that's the four lines. 7 years later, the finished poem appeared in a magazine out of Boston edited by John Wieners. And the magazine was called Measure. And this is the finished poem with a seven-year interval between. This is called Central Park West. Along the walks, the sweet queens walk their dogs and dream of love and diamonds as they pass. And I could be a statue or a stone as they walk by me dreaming of their gods. Beside their path, an apple's throw away, I see that old erotic garden where our parents breathed the wasteful loving air before the angry gardener changed his will. The park has no room for that memory. Its paths are twisted like a scattered sky of foreign stars. The spinning queens go by within their orbits, leaving me alone. What cosmic joy! The last companion here is Priapus, the gardener's ugly son, who crouches in the bushes with his shears and hasn't got the hots for anyone. You know, sometimes it takes forever to finish a poem. I would like to close by reading one of my favorites of Spicer, and this is really the first time it has appeared in print. Though it is an early poem and is written either in 49 or 52, sometime in that era. It's called A Postscript to the Berkeley Renaissance. What have I lost? When shall I start to sing a loud and idiotic song that makes the heart rise, frightened into poetry, like birds disturbed? I was a singer once. I sang that song. I saw the thousands of bewildered birds breaking their cover into poetry, up from the heart. What have I lost? We lived in forests then, naked as jaybirds in the ever real, eating our toasted buns and catching flies, and sometimes angels with our hooting tongues. I was a singer once. In distant trees, we made the forest ring with sacred noise of gods and bears and swans and sodomy, and no one but a bird could hear our voice. What have I lost? The trees were full of birds. We sat there drinking at the sour wine in gallon bottles, shouting song until the hunters came. I was a singer once, bird ignorant. Time with a gun said, "Stop, find other forest, teach the innocent." God got another and a third, bird-limed in eloquence. What have I lost? At night, my hooting tongue, naked of feathers and of softening years, sings through the mirror at me like a whippoorwill, and then I cannot sleep. I was a singer once, it sings. I sing the song that every captured tongue sang once when free and once again to sing, but I can sing no song I have not sung. What have I lost? Spook singer, hold your tongue. I sing a newer song no ghost bird sings. My tongue is sharpened on the iron's edge. Canaries need no trees. They have their cage. Phew. That's Jack Spicer. Can you hear me in the back?
Yes.
Is it all right? Okay. I'm getting a little aspirant, so bear with me. Next, we're going to be doing an anthology of new voices, and it's ManRoot 11, and it's getting ready for press now. What did you read out of Personae? Do you know? So that I don't duplicate?
I'm sorry to duplicate.
Oh, that's all right. Okay. In David has already introduced you to Persona Non Gratae last week. This is in its third printing now. I was teaching at a junior high school in northern Illinois in 1960. One and was arrested for becoming sexually involved with my students, which is a no-no in this society. I was hauled off to Cook County Jail and was held there for 9 months with a $100,000 bail on my head for a nonviolent exchange of affection with adolescents. I was declared a sexually dangerous person by the state of Illinois and committed to Menard, Illinois in 1961, and I spent 3 years there. I taught all 3 years that I was there. I taught everything from fourth grade to teaching for the GED test, which men can take to get their high school diploma, and women as well in the outside. I also tutored two college classes while I was there. At one point, I begged the assistant warden to let me become a barber because I knew teaching on the outside would be very difficult to get into, being an ex-convict. And the warden's words were, "Get back in there, that school boy, and teach. I don't want to hear any more out of you." That was that. In prison, I begged to become a barber, to learn a skill, to take care of my head. They wouldn't let me. Instead, I taught and taught their demand. Still, I have no trade and cannot teach. My untrained hands live forever without their hate. Oh, I'm tired of living the lie they lie for me. Skillessly, I live on and on, trying to save my own head from being shaved, my breath from being barbed. Poor Delilah knew the power of grip of such holding companies. I have no skill to fight with, but patience and persistence to live without the holding company's company. And this is a gigolo song. You all know what a gigolo is? Okay. Bobby Martin, Bobby Martin, teeth out, teeth in, Bobby Martin. Gigolo three lathered Bobby's tool, gigolo one shaped three into a flying machine, cool. Gigolo black, gigolo hand, gigolo teeth, gigolo out. Gigolo one, gigolo three, gigolo three, out. Pants pressing Bobby pushed in. Extra pants to gigolo two, gigolo one, kangarooed two. Gigolo laundry, gigolo cards, gigolo pants, gigolo press, gigolo one, gigolo two, out. Foxy Bobby wrapped and feigned, boxed himself into a square deal, flirted, and his teeth got parted. Bobby Martin had all the fun. Teeth out, teeth in, gigolo one. Gigolo one. Can I signal you on the volume on this? Because I don't want to blow it out.
Oh, you won't.
Huh?
It's okay.
Don't say that. The long baking party. Henry, the shuffling bread man, slunk past me every breakfast and loaded the tin plate with his fresh baked bread. He'd been baking it for the last 60 years. He remembered the turn of the century, being behind the turning walls called days, theirs, now his, called bars, called life. He made bread and cut each loaf like a woman, a delicate thrust which he'd first tried out in 1892. A personal taste test, his women, his bread. He cut one, two, many women. So then he had to cut the state a certain number of loaves before he could go home from the long baking, shuffle to the oven party. His life, Christ, was divided. Fish 20, bread 60 years. Now his multitudes are over. Freed, he is just beginning to learn to live all over and to learn to bowl. Each pin is a warden's head. Strike! Now he riots only in his dreams. And the old man that brought me bread every morning for 3 years was paroled, and he had been in the joint since the turn of the century. And he had never seen an electric can opener, he had never seen an elevator, he had never seen an escalator, and he was expected to reintegrate back into this society. And that's the demand that was put upon him. And I saw a newspaper clipping where he was living in a house trailer with a distant aunt in Santa Barbara, and she was teaching him to bowl. And that's the reality of the poem. These get heavy, and I can only do so many of them before wearing myself out. I'll try this one. It's called A Quarry Rock. Called A Reality Poem in the Tradition of Genet. O Seeger, the night you tied the cabbie to the tree and shot him, did you know the shadow of the chair was waiting for you? You murderer, guillotined one, you of the severed head, you on death row for 7 years, you 6'7" taker of life, you with the death-shrouded head. One night, you, walking in line to your cell, swung and touched hands with your love, Stevie. You, too, walking in line to your cell, swung and touched hands. Swung hands and touched. The only way you could say goodnight. Swung hands and touched. Later that same night, Stevie, lying in his 6x9 cell, in the quiet one-man cell, in the quiet of his only home, his desires became rampant, wanting you, touching him, wanting. Oh, Seeger, what have they done to Stevie? What have they done to Stevie? The county had said his voyeur eyes were too blue and should be put away until the color changed to gray. Wanting you, touching him, wanting. The broom became you. The broom became the strength of you. The broom became the reality of you until he fell off the bed and broke the broom off. Inside, where you were, in the quiet of his night, he was visited by red horror, notwithstanding, not waking. O Seeger, the night you tied the cabbie to the tree and shot him, did you know that you would wait 7 years to be strapped in a chair? That they would kill your love in isolation, in lonely isolation? That in the cubicle of a cell you would want him, would want to love him? It was the evening after you knew Stevie had died that I heard green tears whimper from your cell and knew that in that severed head you still had human tears. Oh, Seeker, what have they done to Stevie? What have they done to Stevie? Later, Stevie was taken to Pauper's Field where dandelions grow in reverence to the sun. Whenever his parents refused his body, refused their blood, son, it was then I heard you rage like a wild tiger. In the cold Antigone of your dreams, I saw you in defiance go out to bury the body. And in revenge, you took to the fields looking for his parents, hiding in the forest of your dreams in cabbie clothing. O Seeger, the night you tied the cabbie to the tree and shot him, did you know you still had green tears? My own country. Collected at least 50 rejection slips. Nobody wanted to deal with the subject matter. It was finally published in Canada, in Canada's oldest literary magazine, called The Fiddlehead. And they just celebrated their 25th anniversary. So. While I was in prison, I read profusely. I was in a cell from 4 in the evening until 7 the next morning. And I learned then that I couldn't watch TV. I mean, you know, there was no TV in the cell. You were plugged into earphones and a headset, and it was usually hillbilly music or a football game or Bob Hope from Vietnam or some such mass media. And I said, I can't plug into that. And so I read and wrote profusely while I was in prison, and it was there that I developed a little craft and technique about the honesty and structure of words. Is there any questions so far? I've covered a little material. Feedback, input. I don't know how many of you do it, but if you're really interested in writing, may I suggest that you work on vocabulary? I don't know how to say it, but if you'll keep an active vocabulary list of the words that you don't know and keep looking them up, your vocabulary will change levels, and all I can say is you'll be healthy for it. George Bernard Shaw's writing vocabulary was 75,000 words. Most high school graduates work with 10,000 if they're working at maximum. Most college students are 15,000. And if you're going to be a writer, you need to have command of the language. That's your key. It's not an 88 piano key. This is a book called Apparitions of a Black Pauper's Suit. And the guy who did the front cover, and also there's an apparition of Janis Joplin in here, is a fine artist by the name of Martin Izquierda. And he just did a mural in Melvin Belli's living room. You know. And he used to exhibit with Upper Market Street Gallery in San Francisco. I put this little book together. It's like a book of eulogies, 13 eulogies. And I put it together specifically to, I don't want to say combat, but almost that. Counterbalance is a polite way of saying it. The death cult hero worship of John Berryman, Ann Sexton, Sylvia Plath, I'm waiting for death to come on a white horse and carry me away, suicide pack. And I really feel like I was trying to look at the subject matter, but not from an personal eye point of view, but from a larger persona. An apparition of the black pauper's suit. There's this black pauper's suit that keeps getting new visitors going on journeys to bury the weight of relatives, the very last physical presence of the remains. The callers for the suit are late at night when all else has grayed over in the city. Bunched up in a suitcase with a rolling machine, books, socks, what's left of a son, the suit will come home again to wait for another late caller. In 1968, a couple of weeks before the May riots at Cal, there was a gay man shot and killed at Aquatic Park in Berkeley. Supposedly, he had made a pass at a plainclothes policeman, and he panicked and ran, and he was shot and killed. And a group of us took a casket box over to Berkeley City Hall, painted it black, and marched around it all one day because there was no newspaper coverage whatsoever on it. And this was our way of protesting that senseless death. It's called Snapped Rondelle, and for those of you who like to see things visually, I broke the poem in the middle. I shall forever walk around the casket in the sad circle in front of Berkeley City Hall. I shall forever walk, Frank, you were not there, in the sad circle in front of Berkeley City Hall. I shall forever walk, Frank, you were not there, in the sad circle in front of Berkeley City Hall. I shall forever walk, Frank, you were not there, the police had shot you in front of Berkeley City Hall. I shall forever walk, Frank, you were not there, the police had shot you dead, and we walked around the casket in the sad circle in front of Berkeley City Hall. I shall forever walk. The little black schoolgirl asked, what's in the casket? Nothing, shot back one reply. Death came quick, another, and her rich brown eyes rolled upward, knowing the sad circle in front of Berkeley City Hall. You saw the police fire, knowing there is no just pyre to burn for you. I shall forever walk. The task is to name the demon and to demand the rights hereto unwrit. Murder is the game. The gentle man, once you were, now is no more, and I have to walk and walk and walk and walk and walk some more. In 1968, I went back to San Francisco State to get my master's degree. While I was going to school there, I worked with Robert Duncan privately. He did not teach there. As Duncan's secretary, we had a writing workshop that went for 5 years, meeting every other Wednesday night. And that was an intense CR group if I ever saw one. It was during this period that I wrote Letter to Robert Duncan While Bending the Bow. In 1968, he had just published Bending the Bow. New Directions brought it out. And I had been hearing the poems in workshop, but I hadn't seen the poems. And seeing the poems visually triggered a response. And so I wrote this poem. Part of it's it's like creative, not criticism, but creative response. There are 20 sections to the poem, and I'll read 3 or 4 of them to give you a sense of it. Number 9. Your movements in poetry are Oberon and Puck, Hamlet, Lear, and Othello. All movements in the signet of I, in the lure of the world I love. X is your movement, full-mouthed, open, the neophyte in the body of the poem, allowing X to arousal, body upon body, to be a river, even in the last line, reaching us. 10. Let me give you an illusion, a story, herself, a mother of sorts. Mahogany is another. In the upper regions of passages, as if the air had lips, and you're constantly kissing the poem into birth, lusting the Lord in antlered crown. 11. He had a poem called Wine. Are you going to write it, Robert? There it was in the middle of your wine, a variation upon the theme of the blind violin. If I say Yeats, Joyce, Creeley, Duncan all have eye trouble, and the violin of poetry is a variation of blindness, that extra strength in seeing is seeing poetry, the wine, the contagion, the music, and you are the instrument of blindness, railing the world in relief sculptures, books, ditches, shelters of agony, agona wooing the world with thick perfumes. Du cochon, donnez-moi un cadeau, j'ai une de poésie. And this is like, if I have a credo, then I would like for this to be a part of that credo. And it's part 16 in this book. These are my 20 passages in your field. 1, the structure is always rhyme. The problem is that the reader has 2, to answer the tone he sought that sought him. And 3, to be David, Saul, and Orpheus in one song. And 4, to sing. When I think what the reader has to do, it multiplies. 5, to mirror the stag's face. 6, to hunt the stag in heat. 7, to hunt the stag in an open field. 8, to conjure Diana's songs and Diana's muse. 9, to weigh the word as an actual stone in the hand. 10, to move naked as the wind in a world of words. 11, to enter the poem sacredly, like a mouth, an anus, a cunt. To climb inside the poem like pajamas, to climb inside the word as if it were a cave. To bear the eternal cross, Hiroshima, Treblinka, Selma, Memphis, Birmingham, Mobile, Stanleyville, Seoul, Saigon, Washington, D.C., and other Texas places, Dallas. 14, to skip 14 eyes and think of one set cross. 15, to go along the open road singing like a tramp, a whore, a housewife, a lover, a midwife to the world of poetry. 16, to dance like we fairies dance, or at least to watch gracefully. 17, to wash the city's walls with graffiti. Jockey shorts cause cancer. Love sucks. What this country needs is a good 24-hour mustache wax. J. Edgar Hoover uses a nightlight. Up thou, our country right or wrong. 18, to be more than a one poem Charlie, to be more than a shaman. 19, to see chaos, the yawning abyss, and to see ourselves in the open field surrounding the abyss. 20, to see the hawk in oneself, to see the chicken in oneself, to see the dove in oneself, then go blind, only to play the violin of variations, the blood signs of life that we see in each other. Phew. That's... Do you all know this book? Okay. I brought it along tonight because I feel that it's important that poets share their work. Writers who work alone very much sometimes feel alienated. Writing is usually not done in collaboration with someone until after you have mastered the craft. And this is a directory. It's an international directory of little magazines and small presses. And this is the 11th edition, 1975 and 1976. And every year they do a new one. Lynn Fulton does it up in Paradise, California. But it lists little magazines from all over the world. Some of them are not so little. Paris Review, Transatlantic Review, Poetry Chicago. And then little mimeographs, you know, from Salt Lake or Topeka or Madison, Wisconsin, or wherever. Anyway, this is an index or a directory of those magazines. And they tell you what kind of material they want. They tell you how many pages. They tell you whether they pay or give you copies or give you a year subscription. And I think it's important that you share your work. I don't think there's going to be a recluse Emily Dickinson in this century where your work is going to be buried with you and we have to dig you up to find your poetry. The century is moving much too fast for that. So I would suggest that maybe you could get one in the library here as a reference book. I'll pass that to David. Let's take a 10 or 15 minute break. Now I'm running down, dry mouth, right? And start again at, say, 8:30. It's about 10, 12. This is about a spoon ring, and spoon rings are very popular in the pop culture today. They're used in prison as a part of a bonding ceremony or between two men. And this is what happens. Shakedown and more. Silver is missing from the mess hall. All prisoners suspect. Cells torn open like wounds, setting out in search of the germ. The spoon stolen. Each frisked as he returns to his cell. Shakedown for contraband. All known hands are checked for shivs. One lives in terror that it's not marked for him. Still, it may be found as a ring on a newly wedded hand, or as a worse attack, a knife in the back. Mattress uprighted, all belongings searched, scattered, the box of paperclips spilled, strewn all over. You two have been very distracting all evening, okay? And I want to say that publicly. Thank you. Mattress uprighted, all belongings searched, scattered, the box of paperclips spilled, strewn all over concrete floor. Stations of order, disorder, guards waylay all objects. Everything in cell has been touched, handled by huge hands. Nothing is left untouched. Sacred letters, emptied envelopes, green water glass. No thing is found. Everything in cell has been shaken down. One of the unfortunate things that I see happening in prison is electrotherapeutic shock. They have it at San Quentin, at Folsom, Vacaville, Atascadero. And the pattern that I see is it's used to break up black and white couples that walk the yard together because the administration doesn't want to see them together. Always we watch them. They watch us always. You and I see their thugs drag blonde Patrick out and down the walkway to the shock room. We know the routine. In weeks, Patrick will reappear on the yard, in the circle, walking off their cast, muttering inconsequential nothings loudly, very loudly, for all his days to come. He is now among their number, his ears numbed to darkness, ache, sputterings of electric circuit tangle his mind. He is engaged to marry the electric holding company. I don't have any easy solution to the prison dilemma that is about the nation. We were talking outside a minute ago, and just for some statistics, the recidivism rate in some states, recidivism means going back to prison for a second time, okay? Those who repeat, those repeaters. In some states, the prison recidivism rate is as high as 70 or 80%. So that for every 100 men that get out, men and women that get out, 80 of them are going back to prison. And that's the statistics in some states. And I think that's an incredible statistic. And those people are really trapped in a syndrome of going back to a society they feel stable in, and that's the only place they feel stable in, or in a mental institution. And I think we've got to answer to what is missing in our society that they have to go back there to feel safe, or that's the only way, where place they can live. In 1968 and 1969, when I was working at SF State on my master's degree, I was working with Kay Boyle, and she is now in her early 70s. I worked with her as her secretary to help pay my way back to school. And I, you know, felt very strange to suddenly type a lecture that she was going to deliver at the Sorbonne in a week. She was James Joyce's secretary, and she helped type the Ulysses manuscript. She's always been an activist in that she does take political stands. She helped organize the march against the nuclear subs in 56, I think that was. Anyway, while I was a student of hers out at SF State working on my master's and her personal secretary, she laid herself down on the Oakland Army induction terminal sidewalk and got hauled off to Santa Rita. She was a mother 5 times and a grandmother about 16 times. So this is my letter to Kay Boyle at Santa Rita. Why must you scrub more walls, more floors on your grandmother's knees? It is not only walls and floors that need cleansing, but all structures. Oh, how do we build a city for the dead? Brittany and France, Arlington, Forest Lawn. Not every officer is killed by enemy bullets. We are but arbiters in a larger dispute with our own citizenry over war. Too many young soldiers live in the city for the dead. You, noble woman, and others are among those walkers that picket consciousness without firing a weapon, without firing property. We are anthracite, fuel of a nation, black minimus drawn against holy names. We are among the company of the living. We lick the cold sweat from the structures, bend our spines to the floor, and from our knees we whisper to each other, how goes it with thee? I think this is a chant for the Vietnamese Buddhist. Two by two, they filed by in their saffron robes. Miles to the village they walked, walked miles to the village. Between the two armies they walked to the village and left two by two, left the village two by two with villagers between them, saving them from the armies the villagers left in between. The saffron robes two by two, they left the village miles away from the village. They walked, walked miles away from the village. Between the two saffron files of robes, the villagers walked away from the armies. That's a simple poem. There's only 17 words in it. And the effect is through repetition. So it does become a chant. Okay. I think I'll just read some other miscellaneous things for a while. And I'll, we've had a request for the Janus poem. And what did you say?
Spoon ring,
right, okay. While loving you with your closed eyes, I wish I knew whom you see. Somehow you give the feeling it isn't me. This was a scene from outside my window. I live on DuBose Street in San Francisco, and there's a little park there. And I was watching one day, and this woman came up and fell incredibly in love with a big St. Bernard. I call it anima rondo. She fell in love with the St. Bernard. He fell in love with her. The St. Bernard fell in love with whoever fed him. He fed him a lot. He fell in love with her. He wanted to sleep with her. She wanted to sleep with the St. Bernard. She fell in love with the St. Bernard. The St. Bernard fell in love with whoever fed him. Your hands say the things you forget to say, the things your hands say. It's called From Both Sides, and it opens with an epigram from De Sade, and the epigram reads, Nero married Tigellinus as a woman, and he married Sporus as a man. I don't know where De Sade got his underground information about Nero, but I think I can substantiate it through Cicero if I looked. This is called From Both Sides. Love, I've seen you from both sides, lying together as you do, male and female, with tongue running from breast to taut nipple of chest, from eternal cave to tip of rod, running inside the cave, an inhabitant traversing in strokes of measured inches, inches, and tongue running up sack seam, head engulfing the flower and its stamen, the touch of tongue from root to stem, from neck to torso, and based like statued liberty, the phallus gestures upwardly, up manly, from full mouth breast to triangular temple of the huntress eye, lying between the two, am hunted, electric with love, discharge with equal right. I've seen you love from both sides, and have been your man, and have been your woman. And I erect two temples and lie between them, and love, I've seen you from both sides. Hung black leather jacket on my chair, and then let me have it. Whip me with your tongue, lap me till you'd consumed all milk. My body lay empty saucer-like, and you curled up around it and went to sleep almost purring. This morning you removed your jacket from the chair and left without kissing the milk maker goodbye. This is called One Mad Queen. There's no use kidding myself. I can't fuck myself, and there's no use trying. I mean, anatomically, I don't fit that way together, so I've stopped trying. But there's one mad queen here who has learned how to curve the penis under and in. He fucks himself. He doesn't need anyone. Now he has fulfilled himself. Every time I see him, his eyes are nothing but mirrors, and there's no way of reaching him. He has no doors. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairiest of us all? One mad queen, a million voyeurs. I have